Hi everyone, welcome to our webinar on decarbonisation of transport. I'm Tracy Lake, I'm a partner in the energy team at Weightmans. We're looking today at what I think is actually one of the hot topics of our lifetime. I think you can't switch on the television or listen to the radio these days without hearing about energy and transport and the collaboration between those industries. I think it's probably a collaboration between sectors in a way that we haven't seen before, and it's really exciting. Today you'll hear from a great cast of speakers who join us from companies within the energy and logistics industries, and those panelists will present on what their businesses are doing to help achieve a carbon-free transport future and give their views on how we'll get there. So if we look at the next slide, you'll see the list of speakers and their logos, which is always great to have on the slide. I'll introduce each speaker in turn, and then following their presentation, the panelist will ask a poll question. So if you can look out for those poll questions, please, and participate, we'd be grateful. Try to think of your answer as quickly as you can. We'll probably give you about 30 seconds to do that and then feedback. Also, do feel free to use the chat function to ask any questions, and we'll have a question and answer session at the end. So without further ado, it's my pleasure now to introduce Simon Kendrew. Simon has more than 20 years experience working with leading brands across a range of sectors, including telecoms, retail, energy and technology. And Simon's role is now as marketing director at Engie EV Solutions. Simon, over to you.
Thank you, Tracy. And good afternoon, everyone. So I'm Simon Kendrew, marketing director for Engie EV Solutions. And over the next 6 or 7 minutes, I want to really pose a few questions and get thinking about this topic of decarbonising transport and what are some of the key themes and considerations for all of us as ultimately investors in this new and emerging space. So if we can move on to the next slide, please. Just first, a very quick introduction to Engie. So we are a global energy and services business, employing about 170,000 people around the world. And a big part of what we do and our offering is in e-mobility and EV services. Within the UK, we focus on three areas. We focus on energy, regeneration and services. And there's around 17,000 of us overall helping to deliver this. And the thing that really, really holds us together is our mission to make zero carbon happen. And obviously decarbonizing transport is one of the key strands to enable this. So within the UK, we operate the EV solutions business, and this is made up of two elements. Firstly, we own and operate the Genie Point network, which is a public charger network. So if you have an EV, you can go and charge at one of hundreds of rapid charging stations around the UK. And we have over 60,000 drivers now who we support on a daily basis. And the second part is in third-party charging, where we work with organisations to help them implement EV solutions within their offices, within their depots, ultimately helping that transition for fleets, for employees, for customers to make the move to electric transport. So today, as I said, we're going to cover two areas and hopefully just get us thinking a bit around this topic. So if we could move on to the next slide. And the first area is thinking about actually what is it we're doing here and this new fueling experience that we're creating. So on the left of the screen, you see what is probably typical for most of the UK today when we're traveling around, and we will visit on a several times a week or weekly or monthly basis. You know, we'll pop into a petrol and diesel station and fill up our cars. And that's quite well known. It's well known behaviour. But actually, this new world we're talking around, it's much more complicated and offers lots of different solutions. And as EV drivers, we can now charge in a range of different locations, whether it might be at home, whether it's at work, whether it's at various destinations. There are rapid charging hubs emerging around the country. alongside, you know, smaller rapid charging units and on-street charging. So this creates a whole new set of considerations for drivers, for organisations, for businesses looking to make this switch around, actually, how do we tie all this together? And although it perhaps first appears more complicated, we would argue that actually it's a very positive shift. So it suddenly gives choice, it gives options to customers and enables the right solution for them. But as a newcomer into the market, it's not always easy. So we know that the majority of charging actually happens at home or in the workplace, 80 to 90% typically. But it does raise questions around, you know, where do we invest? How many different types of chargers do we need in what locations? What technologies? What type of charging, or even what type of refueling? So we're, you know, focusing here on EV, but there are lots of different options that can open up. How do I equip my fleet for this new world and enable my drivers to be able to get the power they need when they need it? So at Engie, we're looking at how we tie this together and how we try and simplify this from a customer side so that they can have actually a seamless experience across all these locations and make the most of what is a new but actually an exciting refueling experience that moves us away perhaps from where we've been in the past. Then the second area, which I think also deserves consideration very much so, is around the customer. So if we can maybe step on to the next slide, and I think this is where if we step back for a minute and consider what are we all a part of as we go through this journey, and actually it's really exciting. So you know the chart on the right here, you've probably seen various versions of this, which is looking at what do we predict EV take up will be in the future. There are lots of different models, there are lots of different views, but they all follow roughly a trajectory that's something along the lines of what we can see on the right. And to put this into context, there are today around about 450,000 plug-in electric vehicles on the road, around half of which are pure battery, the other half hybrid. By the time we get to 2025, you know, we're forecasting that number will be around 2 million, and then it will grow, you know, exponentially from there. And to put this into context, there are over 30 million cars on the road today. So we're still talking around actually something that's very, very new, it's very nascent, but it's growing at a phenomenal pace. And we all have the opportunity as, you know, key drivers, as key investors within these areas, whether we're looking at how we move our businesses into this space, whether we're looking at the infrastructure and technology development as we are doing in Engie, or whether we're looking as a personal driver, we've all got an opportunity to shape this and to be part of this market and this industry that is set to grow and continue to grow, you know, over the next decade and beyond. But then when we think about the driver and actually the customer, you know, there are some key things that are coming through. So, you know, the experience today, we know that customers are wanting reliability, ease of use, and to understand and have a fair price. And it's very much in that order. So at the top of the list today, it's really around reliability and simplicity. That's what customers are looking for. So how do we deliver that? We're really focusing on pushing that. From a policy perspective, there are a lot of moves from government around funding. I think we'll come on to look at some of that in more detail, you know, both at a business level, at an infrastructure level, at a personal level, to help make this shift, but also increasingly a move into actually how do we ensure the right customer experience. So there are a number of consultations taking place today which are looking to put in place the right mechanisms, the right platforms to improve the experience for drivers and ensure that that's what it needs to be. And then also thinking about the drivers themselves and the needs of how that is going to emerge in the coming years. So, you know, back to the chart on the right, we're very much still within that early adopter segment. So, you know, the people who are driving EVs are typically, more driven by the technology. They're interested in having the latest and then, they're that early adopter kind of really passionate about what they're doing. But we're now seeing this start to move as we move into mass market. So again, we need to be thinking as an industry around the future segments, future drivers, the needs that will be coming in as this market evolves, whether that's private, whether it's fleet, whether it's looking at taxi drivers and all these different areas that will be emerging. And ultimately what we're focusing on within Engie is around how can we make this transition as easy as possible? How can we move people into this new world of refueling and support our customers in enabling this transition to EV? So hopefully that's given some thoughts and starters to get us going. I think we will move on to a poll now, I believe, which will be your first chance to feed in some thoughts. So here we go. So first of all, we thought it'd be interesting to think about or to get feedback from yourselves around what are the main barriers for you and your organisations within this market looking to adopting EV, whether it's for your fleet or for your employees. There's a number of options on there. We'll give you about 20 or 30 seconds if you could start responding, and then we'll come back and see those results. Exciting, we've not seen this happen before. So infrastructure. So interestingly, actually, the infrastructure has come out there very much in the lead at 60%. Perceptions around expense second, and then closely followed by the lack of expertise. And interestingly, this is actually something that we do see within the customers we work with, and certainly perhaps want to discuss later. You know, the need to keep growing the infrastructure and build that infrastructure is obviously critical for enabling businesses to make that shift. So thank you. Thanks for listening. Thanks for your input. Thank you.
Thanks, Simon. Yes, that was a really interesting poll question. We'll hear more about infrastructure later on and how we're going to need infrastructure to make this happen. Next, I'll hand over to Jake Collis. Jake is Octopus Electric Vehicles Senior Partnership Manager. And has more than 9 years of experience in dealing with fleet vehicles. So knowledge of moving what we call grey fleet to electric fleet. And Jake also specialises in salary sacrifice schemes, which he'll tell us about now. Over to you, Jake.
Super. Thanks, Tracy. And thank you, Simon. Hopefully I'll be able to tell you all how I can help you make the switch to EV. Good afternoon, and really, why go electric? I wanted to make it personal from my point of view, off the bat, really. I've just had a baby girl, she's 10 weeks old, and I'm sure you all saw during knockdown how good the air quality was because no one was driving. First and foremost, even though I work for an electric vehicle company, if you can make that journey by walking or cycling, we definitely want you to be doing that. But if you do have to drive, we really want to make sure that it is a zero emission vehicle, especially due to the current air quality that we see in inner city, London and main cities in the UK. Most recently, and it was very poignant, it was a poor little girl, Ella, age 9. Sorry to be so downhearted, but the coroner, for the first time, the coroner said that she passed away due to the poor air quality area that she was living in, just off the South Circular in Lewisham. She had very bad asthma and severe asthma attacks, and unfortunately passed away at only 9 years old. And that was purely down to the poor air quality where she was living. So with a 10-week-old little girl and me pushing her in a pram in just outside of inner London in Twickenham, I really am passionate about getting people to make that switch out of their potentially older and polluting vehicles to a fully electric vehicle. If we go to the next slide, even in my 3 years within the industry, there's a huge array of vehicles coming onto the market that is making it a lot easier for people to switch out of their current petrol or diesel into a pretty much light-for-light vehicle that will be able to meet their day-to-day driving needs. When I first started 3 years ago, pretty much there was only 3 or 4 options, and that was a huge barrier along with range anxiety. Now, these newer models on the market are pretty much on average across the spectrum have got 200 mile range on one full charge. And really that, from Simon's point, for the voting there around infrastructure, that volume of range pretty much helps and takes away some of that worry on having to charge regularly and that infrastructure. I use the example from driving from Twickenham to Leeds, 4-hour drive, 200 miles, you would usually stop for a toilet break or a coffee doing that journey anyway. A full charge of 200 miles will be able to make that, and you would stop for 15 minutes to charge just as a comfort break anyway. And that's a long drive. It's quite funny when you drive a petrol or diesel, you never think how many miles you're driving because you can always stop at a petrol station and not worry about it. But that's one of the main focuses that we help people make that jump and get off that fence and for them to understand that it is possible and it is doing the right thing. If you jump over to the next slide, please. Here at Octopus, I think someone's already touched on it, but people need to understand and we need to help myth bust around making that switch. So I suppose if you're switching your petrol or diesel to a new petrol or diesel, the only stressful thing you've got to think about is what colour do you choose next? Whereby if you're moving to EV, you've got to think about the range, the car, the size of it. A charger to fit at home, or if you don't have a driveway, how do you charge? Where do I charge? How fast it is? Can I get a specific renewable energy tariff for it to be cheaper and greener to charge at home? And who do I go to for someone to answer all these questions? And here at Octopus, we pull all that together to really sort of handhold you through the whole process, have everything in one place, and if you are thinking about it, to really help you make that jump. If you move on to the next slide. And how do we do that? I'm sure a lot of you have heard of salary sacrifice before in terms of pensions and cycle to work schemes. But these schemes sort of died a death 5, 6, 10 years ago due to the high benefit in kind, so company car tax rate on giving someone a company car. Now, the last couple of years, the government have drastically dropped that benefit in kind rate. It was zero last year, 1% this year, and then 2% for the next 3 years. So these schemes have suddenly come back into the forefront of sustainability managers, HR departments, benefit providers, to really, first off, put their hand up and say, we're doing something for our employees, offering them a fantastic benefit, but also helping their sustainability drive as well. And the main concern with these schemes was around offering people company cars and people leaving cars sitting around gathering dust and things like that. We make sure we take a lot of that risk away from the company so that it's cost neutral and a breeze, hopefully, to run a scheme and offer this amazing benefit to their employees. And because the money for the car is taken out of their gross salary, they can save up to 30, 40, 50% on the lease cost. So really not only making it super easy to get a relatively expensive car, which EVs still are, makes it a lot more affordable. And the fact that we can run through total cost of ownership figures compared to what they're paying currently with their own vehicle, it really is starting to stack up and make it a lot easier for a lot more people to make the switch. If we just go to the next slide, please. So a lot of people have moved away actually from owning a vehicle outright because they don't want that hassle of when it gets older, breakdown costs, servicing costs, unexpected breakdowns when you get up in the morning and that's always £1,000 here, £1,000 there. We found that a lot more people, like a mobile phone really, are moving to a contract hire, which the scheme is, with everything included. So it takes away that hassle of having to find an insurance company to go with, a breakdown company to go with, all in 1 month, everything included. All you can really add is a bit of electricity to charge it at home, which you can also help with through the Octopus Energy Go tariff. But really, it's an amazing benefit to not only help a sustainability-driven company, but also for their employees financially. No upfront cost. You know exactly how much you're going to be paying for 2, 3, or 4 years. Save hugely on fuel, but also do the right thing in terms of inner city air pollution. And really, what we found is that once one person takes it up, they have a conversation around the water cooler and they realise how great the opportunity is of getting a car through this scheme, that people jump at the chance to be able to make the switch. As I said, we bring everything together to make it as easy as possible, and it's all about the customer and the end user. And if you don't have a driveway like me, I usually get that pushback. If you don't have a driveway, how do I charge? Where do I charge? We've also got the electric juice network provided by Octopus Energy as well, which is a specific card that works on multiple providers in the public charging network, so that you take away that hassle of having multiple RFID cards, multiple apps, not knowing how and what and why to charge. We try and make that that nightmare change to making it a lot more efficient charging on the road. That's a very high level run through of why I'm so passionate about it and how I can help get your employees switched across. I think we should have a question poll that should come up, hopefully. It'd be great to out the 71 people on the call, how many people do currently own an electric vehicle? And give you, should be a quick and easy one to answer. It'd be great to see how many people have made the plunge. Wow. Okay. So fantastic that you're on this call to learn a bit more. 93% with no. It would be great to get in contact with me if and why, the reasons why you haven't yet. Please do add me on LinkedIn. And if you're not a main decision maker in your company, but really keen to get something like this in place, please do let me know. I can speak to your HR director or benefits provider internally to hopefully, if you want to, make that switch as easy as possible. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jake. I wasn't quite expecting it to be that low, I must admit. It tells a picture, doesn't it?
So yeah, indeed.
Yeah, thanks for that, Jake. Next, I'm happy to introduce Dr. Russell Fowler. Russell is a senior manager at National Grid, looking at National Grid's role in transport decarbonisation, including rapid EV charging and also other modes of transport, so for instance synthetic fuel for aviation. I'll hand over to Russell.
Fantastic, thanks Tracy. Hello everyone. Yeah, my name is Russell Fowler. I work for National Grid, looking at all forms of transport decarbonisation. When I start talking, it's always worth introducing who National Grid are. So if we can move on to the next slide, I'll give a very brief overview of who we are. Most people have heard of National Grid, or more accurately, heard of the National Grid, so the physical wires and the pipes. So that's exactly what we are. So we own the electricity wires in England and Wales. So these are the high voltage lines. So think of these as like the motorways of the energy system. So taking power from power stations. So traditionally, this was fossil fuel stations, coal, oil, gas, and now increasingly renewable power, particularly offshore wind, solar, onshore wind, taking it into the kind of more local network than when it's then fed into your home. You want the road analogy, so the motorways, and then the local roads take you to your homes, offices, and works, for example. I won't read out any stats there, but one thing that we do like to highlight is a very reliable network. So the UK transmission system is incredibly reliable. I won't read that number out because I always stumble over the number of nines after the decimal point. But that works out as a couple of minutes a year of lost power. So a very reliable system. And that's going to be absolutely crucial going forward if we are to electrify transport and to electrify heat after that as well. So if we move on, so why are National Grid kind of interested in transport? So as Tracy alluded to, my job title is Decarbonisation of Transport. So I look at electric vehicles probably 90-95% of my time, then rest of transport for the other part of the time. But if we look at some of the stats here, this is why transport is so important to National Grid to look at decarbonisation. If we look at all the sectors that emit carbon in the UK, transport is the largest sector. It overtook the energy sector around 2016-2017. This is because the energy sector is transitioning from fossil fuels, from coal, oil, gas, and moving to renewables. So It's on the journey that transport is just starting to begin out. So it's moving from dirty fossil fuel to clean renewables, and that's what we need to do for transport. Now, if you break transport down even further, you can see on the chart there that cars really do stick out. They emit far more carbon than any other form of transport there. Not to say that other forms of transport aren't important and we should look at them or we should consider them, but our focus does need to be on passenger cars by the sheer volume of carbon that they emit there. It's also worth taking a step back and thinking, well, it isn't just the CO2 we heard before, it's the air quality as well. So transport accounts for around half of the nitrous oxide emissions. So these are really kind of nasty and contribute to really poor air quality that we have as well. So if you get passenger vehicles, if you get EVs replacing fossil fuel cars, you bring down carbon emissions, but you also massively improve air quality as well. If we talk briefly about the rest of transport, well, what are you going to tackle? So We have heavy goods vehicles and vans. Vans are generally bundled up with cars up to a certain size as well. So you should see small vans as well start to move to electric as well. Then you've got heavy goods vehicle. This is where you start to have a little bit of a head scratch about how am I going to do those, because they're a little bit more difficult to do. Then you've got your little bit more difficult things. You've got shipping, rail, and aviation, which are the real head scratchers. And we could have an entire session where we just talk about how we do those as well, from everything from hydrogen to synthetic fuels, which Tracy mentioned that we look at as well. But if we focus back on electric vehicles in particular, or road transport as well, it's kind of worth thinking that there are lots of ways that we can look to decarbonize those. So if we move on to the next slide, we position ourselves as what we call technology agnostic. So that means we interested in, will we move to the next slide? Yes, I'm not quite sure if that's me. I think that's great, thank you. We're technology agnostic. Yeah. So that means we're interested in electricity and hydrogen as well. So in domestic cars, electric vehicles really have taken off as well. There are a handful of fuel cell hydrogen cars out there. But when you move up to slightly heavier vehicles, there may be a slight differential to play between, am I going to go electric or am I going to go hydrogen as well? Hydrogen is really interesting because, well, how do you make that hydrogen there? So you make the hydrogen from clean electricity. So rather than sending it directly into a vehicle, you create clean hydrogen, or green hydrogen, it's sometimes referred to as well. So there is a market there for heavier vehicles potentially to use hydrogen. So as you move up the weights, heavy goods vehicles, rail, maritime and aviation will look to use hydrogen as well. As an energy network, it's about, well, how do you create that hydrogen? So you need to move that renewable electricity to be able to create that hydrogen. So let's get it from where it's produced in offshore wind, for example, to kind of local hydrogen production. So it's moving energy from one place to another. If we go even further down the line, we may have to create what's called blue hydrogen. So this is taking natural gas, stripping the carbon off it, burying it underground, and then taking the hydrogen out of that. That may be some time off. A lot of research, a lot of work needs to be done there, but there could be a potential in the future where you move to more of a hydrogen economy. But for the time being, we're talking focus on electric vehicles. That's very much what we're looking at. If we move on to the next slide, it's, well, how does National Grid get involved in that? Because we've heard before, most people like to charge at home. You have an electric vehicle and you charge at home, brilliant. Or you get to where you're going, your work or your supermarket, and then you charge there. But there is that kind of en route charging that we've touched on as well. So if you are going on a long journey, how can I have confidence that if I'm doing a journey outside the range of the vehicle, you may only do that a couple of times a year, but you definitely still want to be able to do that in your electric vehicle. Do I have confidence that I can pull it on a motorway services and say charge up my electric vehicle in a reasonable amount of time? And it could also base on what if I don't have ability to charge my car at home? Can I go somewhere like a petrol station where I could just plug in for a short amount of time, top up my vehicle if I need to do that as well? So it's really kind of looking at that, what we call the, almost the en route. So it's not your home and it's not your destination, but you're going there really for the purpose of just fueling up your, or recharging your vehicle, I should say. And as we know, range anxiety has been touched on. That's one of the big barriers to uptake of electric vehicles. People want to see a network that will give them confidence, like they have a petrol station, they can see it, and continuity. They want to be able to go up there and say, I know how a petrol station works. If I drive to Scotland, I don't worry if there's a petrol station. And equally, I don't worry, how's this petrol station going to work? Is it going to have a different nozzle? Am I going to have some strange carb to pay? No, I just pay with my contactless. So about confidence and continuity. So if we move on to the next slide, we can see that work has been looked at here. So government has in fact acknowledged this as an issue and looked at addressing it through what they call Project Rapid. So it committed £950 million in the various budgets. So this amount of money has built up over budgets and spending reviews over the last year or so. So over the next 5 years to support the rollout of a rapid charging network. And this isn't to put the charge points in place. This is to make sure that the infrastructure behind them is in place. So let's make sure we have the wires that take you from the electricity network, from the transmission system, actually to run it. That's where the real expense, that was where the real investment needs to be done. What's put on the front is relatively cheap and relatively liquid market. There are lots of charge point providers that you can go in and give you that service. It's making sure the infrastructure behind that is in place to do that. And the idea that you'll be within 30 miles on the motorway services with one of these rapid chargers. So it's giving you that confidence again to go out there. And by the end of the project, you'll be looking around 6,000 kind of ultra rapid chargers across the motorway. Again, given that confidence and that continuity when you're going across the network. So if I go on my final slide, again, it's really is about grid infrastructure is really key to enable transport decarbonisation. You need to get the energy from where it's produced, but it's got to be produced from renewable electricity. You need to move it across the network into people's homes, but also into kind of rapid charging infrastructure. So we really do need to think about infrastructure up front. So when we're thinking about what transport wants, we need to think about the grid infrastructure at least at the same time, because there's a real risk that the grid infrastructure will become a barrier to uptake of electric vehicles. And how do we get around that? Of course, it's collaboration. It's events like this where different parts of the industry talk to each other, so everyone understands what the needs, the concerns, the timings, and the costs are as well, so we can kind of work together to come up with the best solutions. Hopefully I've stuck to my time there. So I think there should be another poll question come up. So let's see if that comes up. There are my contact details there if anyone wants to pick up. So kind of a bit of a bigger question here. So when do you think road traffic will need to be zero emission? So we know by 2050 we have a net zero target. So when do we think we need road traffic to be zero emission to meet that target? So we've got 2035, 2040, 2045, or 2050. Just give people a few seconds to think about that. As well, I'm always thinking about these things, about some of these things actually aren't that far away. Certainly 2035 is where I think that's a long time away. That's 13 and a half years away. That is not long term if you take into the infrastructure and the number of times it takes to get vehicles away. So what do we have there? I would say that's pretty much a tie between 2035, 2040. Handful of people think a little bit later there. I think that kind of broadly ties in where the government thinking or what the thinking is that transport has to go kind of earlier in this journey than some other areas there. So that's really interesting that most people are aligned with 2035, 2040, which is kind of broadly where people are looking for transport. That's really interesting and definitely one to pick up in the Q&A session later. Thank you, everybody, and look forward to questions later.
Thank you, Russell. Again, another interesting poll there, and interesting to hear you talk about the infrastructure that's required and National Grid's role in that. Thanks very much. Now I'm delighted to introduce Phil Rowe, who is the Chief Customer Officer and Director of Strategy at DHL Supply Chain. Phil has for more than 17 years been in various strategic operational roles at DHL and has responsibility for leading the sales, marketing and customer experience teams. He's also Chief Operations Officer and Managing Director for DHL's transport business. So with your very funky background, Phil, I'll hand over to you.
Thank you, Tracy, and hi, everybody. Thanks for the opportunity to come and talk today. Just a little bit about who we are, and then we'll get to the matter in hand. So DHL's largest logistics operator in the UK, employing about 50,000 people and just over 8,000 vehicles. So the challenge of decarbonisation is a really big one for us. And we're not starting today, I'm glad to say. Next slide, please. So we started actually on the road of decarbonisation initially in 2008. So it feels like a long, long time ago. But I think it was really great that we recognised the necessity at that point. And along that journey, it's been a bit bumpy along the way. Some big things I would point out that have happened in 2015. We actually started manufacturing our own electric vehicles. And that was for the half of Deutsche Post, which is the post office in Germany. So half our people are the post office, if you like, in Germany. We couldn't get electric vehicles at that stage. So we started building them ourselves, and we're still doing to this day. I've driven one, actually. They're fantastic. And we set ourselves a whole series of targets to achieve. Initially, it was about getting to 30% improvement in carbon efficiency. And we got to that position in 2016. And I'll talk a little bit more about the UK actually in a moment. But of course, that's a start, but it's no more than a start, really. And what we've really got to focus on is how we meet the challenge going forward, because I think, as we saw in the earlier presentations, the timescales and the challenge is accelerating. So next slide, please. If you could just build it all the way through, please, please, Charlotte. So what this little diagram does the two wavy lines, the top one represents our warehouses. So in the UK, we have 400 warehouses across the UK. And the second bottom wavy line is our transportation, the 8,000 vehicles or so. And I guess if I characterise what we've been doing up to, largely up to today, it would be in that burn less box. And actually, it's been pretty successful for us. If you look at the UK only, we've reduced our transport CO2 by about 31%. But if you look at the warehousing, we've reduced that by just under 80%. And I think it shows that actually behavioural change, building certification, taking advantage of the technologies that are available to us, that those things have been much more advanced, much more quickly in the warehousing side than they have on the transport side. And we've tried lots of new things. We created a company making solar power for vehicles called Trailer, which has been tremendously successful and is now fitted all over the world on buses and cabs and lorries as well. But the next phase is really important to us. And the next phase is actually not just burning less, but burning much cleaner fuels. And there isn't a magic bullet here. We know that the fuels that we can move to are ultimately better than the best diesel technologies. And of course, the best diesel technologies are much better than previous. Euro 6 is over 10 times better than Euro 5 diesel engines, for example. And gas-powered vehicles, although they do give something of a CO2 benefit, depending on how you source the gas, they're also much better on things like NOx, as Dr. Fowler pointed out earlier on. But our approach here has to be the best we can with the technology that is available. And that's why we don't know clearly here, whether battery power will be the long-term winner in every area of vehicles, or whether hydrogen will come in, or whether the UK government will adopt the same approach that's been done in Germany of putting power lines over motorways. So what we have to do is to be the best we can and keep a really open mind on how we do this. And that's why 7 years ago, we built the first safe, clean and quiet gas-powered vehicle for urban logistics. And it's why last year we also started to operate in the UK the largest battery-powered heavy goods vehicle with our friends from Volvo. So how far we burn clean is going to depend partly on the technology, but it's also going to depend hugely, I think, on the point that's been raised on one of the poll answers and that Dr. Fowler raised around infrastructure as well. But there is plenty to go at, and actually by adopting these fuels, we really can move forward. And we've seen that with our gas vehicles. You know, we're now at a point where we're ordering whole fleets worth of gas vehicles rather than running just one-off vehicles. And I think we know that our solution is going to be a mixture of all fuels and all types because of the different weight and size of vehicles that we run. So let me just take you to the next slide and I'll try and explain that in a bit more detail. So you can see there a little diagram that's looking at transport specifically. The top part of that, the 30%, is where we've got to through behaviour, through solar, through aerodynamics, through really close measurement, through telemetry of driver behaviour and performance. And that's been fantastic in terms of engaging with people as well, because people are fascinated and really passionate about this and want to be a part of it as you move forward, and we've given the ability to do that. But our next stage, to take that up to the 80%, really does depend on the adoption of different fuels. At the moment, at the bottom, at the small end of the market, so vans are moving up, I think we can see a route forward where electric vehicles with the right infrastructure and the ability to charge en route can be a really important part, you know, up to maybe 2,000 vehicles within our fleet. But of the heavy end of the fleet, where we're moving 44 tons, where those vehicles are doing typically 400 miles a day, then we really, it really does depend on how well the technology is going to depend on start on electrics, and also what's going to happen with hydrogen, I think. And so our approach, our methodology here is to be the best that we can, to be an early adopter of technologies, to validate that those technologies work, and then to move forward and do wide scale adoption. Okay, final slide. So that's actually the electric vehicle that I was talking about a minute ago, running around London. So you know, where are we? Decarbonisation is a given. You know, we've committed as a business to invest huge quantities of money in decarbonising our operations globally. You know, we've committed just recently $7 billion of investment between now and 2030 to reduce our carbon footprint. We've committed to electrify 60% of our vehicles over the same period, and to move to sustainable fuels as well. So, you know, we're seriously into this. We don't know which or of the technologies is going to work in what circumstances, so we can't close down and should not close down our approach to the market. But we do need the infrastructure, and we need the collaboration that Dr. Fowler talked about earlier on, I think was mentioned. And, you know, if I just give you a couple of key facts, out of our 400 sites, half of our fuel in the UK comes from 68 of them. So if we can find collaboratively the solutions for the infrastructure for whatever fuel is the right fuel, yeah, then this is entirely within our grasp. So thank you very much for your time today. And I think I've sneaked in two questions actually on the poll. So that's a privilege of going last, I think, guys, but there you go. First one, approximately, and this is gut feel, no one's quoting you on this, but what percentage of your current transport activity is on alternative fuel vehicles in the businesses that you work in? And we put don't know, because it's perfectly valid to not know, I think. So quick answer of that question first, please. We'll give it a little bit of time, and then I think can we get the second question up after we've had the answer to the first one, please, Charlotte? How are we doing? Have we got many answers coming in? It's the moment of truth, is it not? Oh, that was the question, you just got off the screen, I can't remember. So less than 10%, I think. And a big shout out to the 11 folk who said, well, I just actually don't know. Yeah. Have we got answers to the second one on there as well? Can we scroll that down? Yeah. I don't know if anybody can see it, but if you can probably scroll it down on your own. But that's saying we need to move to 50% would be, and again, you know, six people not knowing. But that, I think, really illustrates the size of the task. And when you're looking at warehouses and when you're looking at vehicles, you're looking at asset life cycles of typically on warehouses up to 10 to 15 years, and on vehicles of between 5 and 8 years. So actually the decisions that we make now are absolutely critical. Thank you very much for your time.
Thanks, Phil. It's really nice to end that presentation on a positive. I think this is all within our grasp. And again, you mentioned, as some of the other presenters did, about collaboration. And as with everything in life, I think that's key. And we're seeing that today. So thanks for that. Charlotte, if you can move to the next slides, please. So we've heard from the panelists there about how they're preparing for decarbonisation of transport. And if we look at the next slide, we can see actually that there has been a build up to this. So although we're now starting to see a little bit more detail in terms of what the government expects and has committed to, This started a long time ago. So, you know, we had the Climate Change Act, didn't we, in 2008, that actually where we agreed what those targets would be in terms of CO2 emissions. And back then, the target for the UK was actually a reduction of 80% compared to 1990 rates of CO2 emissions. Then as a UK government, we signed up in 2016 to the Paris Agreement, and the UK, as well as all the other participants, have had to report on that since. I think there's been good, steady progress from the UK government following that. We saw in 2017 the government's air quality plan, and that focused very much on transport, actually, with £1 billion of investment in charging infrastructure, which we've already discussed, for low emission vehicles, and that included some schemes for grants as well. There was £89 million back then invested for the Green Bus Fund. So not forgetting that we are a nation that loves to get on the bus, and we're still being encouraged to do so by government. That Green Bus Fund was for local authorities and bus companies to work together to put more than 1,200 new low carbon buses on the roads. But acknowledging that actually there was still a lot of old buses, there was also a fund, the Clean Bus Technology Fund, which bus companies and local authorities could access in order to retrofit existing vehicles. Around that time was also invested £1.2 million in cycling and walking. And there's been a big push in the investment strategy around cycling and walking. And I think, as Jake mentioned earlier, there is still that push from government to use different modes of transport rather than getting in even an electric vehicle. Then we moved to the Climate Change Act target amendment order. So I mentioned earlier that the initial target was to reduce emissions to 80% of 1990 levels. The amendment order that's listed there on this slide has changed that now to 100%. So in other words, we're going for a net zero on CO2 emissions. We're the first of the first major economy to legislate to achieve net zero greenhouse gas emissions by 2050. Since that time, the government's announced its net zero review, because in all of this, you have to consider how this is going to be funded. So the net zero review is considering mechanisms to ensure that there is equality in terms of how stakeholders will pay for this. So whether that's households, businesses, taxpayers, they're trying to get the balance right, but at the same time trying to maximise opportunities for economic growth. And then in 2020, the year that I think most of us want to forget, we did finally see the Energy White Paper after waiting for quite some time. So this was powering our net zero future, which built on the 10-point plan that was also delivered last year. And the 10-point plan for a green industrial revolution, as it's known, published 10 points to build on to get us to where we need to be, with three of those focusing on transport. So points 4, 5, and 6, looking respectively at zero emission vehicles, green public transport, cycling and walking, and point 6, aviation and maritime. And we'll talk a little bit more about those modes of transport later on. So we're waiting now, I think, for the transport decarbonisation plan. That, as I said, there's lots of policy, there's been lots of work ongoing. We know that from what we saw in the Energy White Paper that electric vehicles, in terms of the revolution, is well on its way, but we need to look at other modes of transport. The government did say, though, in that plan that sale of new petrol and diesel cars and vans will end by 2030, which is actually 10 years sooner than originally planned. And then from 2035, all new cars and vans must be zero emission at the tailpipe. So there's that time frame in between 2030 and 2035, where any new cars and vans that are sold that emit from the tailpipe have to have something called significant zero emission capability. That hasn't been defined, and we're waiting the outcome of consultation to define that. I think the white paper also acknowledged that electrification isn't the answer for all modes of transport, particularly HGVs. So funding trials now to identify other fuels such as hydrogen. And I think we just wait and see now what the detail is in that plan. Next slide, please, Charlotte. Thank you. So as I've alluded to, it's not all about EVs and electrification. There are these other modes of transport that we need to consider. Roads is definitely far more advanced. So we've heard already about rolling out charge points, grants for incentives to buy those electric vehicles. Around £500 million has also been invested by the government for innovation and technology, which, as you can imagine, we're going to need to do this, and particularly to support the development of the EV supply chain. We'll need to enable mass scale production of batteries. So you'll have probably heard of those, the gigafactories that will be constructed to do this. Must mention clean air zones. You might tell from my accent, I suppose, I'm a Brummie, and in Birmingham, very soon, actually on the 1st of June, there will be a clean air zone. So there are four types of zones, class A to D, which basically, if you're not driving a vehicle within that zone, which is an ultra low emission vehicle, you'll have to pay a fee. There are some exemptions, but generally those are the rules. Main thing with road transport, of course, is, as people have already mentioned, is the anxiety around charging, and we need the infrastructure in place. But generally, in terms of roads, we're working towards it. So in terms of EVs and cars and small vans. Buses, again, I said earlier, we're a nation that wants to get on the bus. So we've got the National Bus Strategy, which was unveiled in March. They like to put really interesting names on these things. Bus Back Better is what it's called. So that's a plan to introduce hundreds of miles of new bus lanes, build over 4,000 British made electric or hydrogen buses. And as part of that, they'll also look at simplifying bus fares, introducing daily price caps, contactless payments. And really they're hoping that local authorities will be collaborating with bus companies. If we look at cycling, again, a strategy on cycling with the 2020 Cycling and Walking Plan for England. There's a new funding body, an inspectorate called Active Travel England, which is looking at that. And local authorities are working hard on trying to address people's fears about cycling, mostly concerned around safety. So looking to introduce measures to address this, such as protected physical separated cycle paths, traffic calming, and secure parking of bicycles on the streets, because theft is a concern as well. COVID has also made government have another look at this. So as part of the response to COVID, the Department for Transport has announced another £225 million of investment for the Emergency Active Travel Fund. So this is to support councils in reallocating road space to cycling and walking. Another way to get around on the road, I must mention, is e-scooters. So again, we've probably all had experience of these zipping around, but the Department for Transport accelerated some trials are going on for the introduction of regulations to legalise e-scooters. That trial will run until autumn this year, and they'll capture data on use of those scooters and particularly on safety issues, because use of e-scooters on pavements is a prime concern and is likely to continue to be illegal. At the moment, e-scooters are classed as motor vehicles, so users do require some kind of driving license, but I think that is likely to be reviewed in the government's decision. As a firm, we've seen lots of collaboration in this space. We've advised local authorities, universities and scooter operators on several of these schemes. And you know, you consider the commercial agreement, the operating agreement itself, but then you have to think about some of the liabilities that go with that, whether potential criminal sanctions for misuse of the scooters or civil liabilities arising in damages. So it's going to be interesting, I think, to see the findings from the government's trial on e-scooters. So that sort of deals with road and ways that we get around on the road. Rail is slightly easier because electrification works, although we're still waiting for the Williams Rail review that's now actually become the Williams Shapps plan for rail because Grant Shapps, the Transport Secretary, has got involved. So we'll wait and see what that says. Air is probably the toughest mode of transport to deal with in terms of decarbonisation. Again, industry is working with government on this to identify technologies and alternative fuels. As you can imagine, we all know electric batteries are not really feasible on planes due to their weight. And although hydrogen fuel cells are a possibility, that there are some technical barriers with use of hydrogen in aviation due to the density of the hydrogen itself, as well as safety issues. But the government's looking at all of this, and there are various research and development projects, and it's also established the Jet Zero Council. Just to mention marine, again, we've got a very long-standing marine industry, and £20 million is to be invested in the Clean Maritime Demonstration Programme to look at clean maritime technology. There are already some hydrogen ferry trials going on and hydrogen refueling points. So marine, not to be forgotten. Next slide, please. Charlotte, thanks. So as you'll have picked up from the things that we've been talking about, there's a lot of law and regulation around all of this. So how can we help you? If you just consider regulation for a minute, regulation can help, but existing regulation doesn't really deal with the future world. So there will need to be some changes, and government obviously will consider regulation and legislation going forward. But if we use EV charging as an example, we'll need to consider whether an electricity supply license would be required under the Electricity Act, because selling electricity amounts to a supply of electricity, and supply in itself is a licensable activity. So Ofgem would need to grant a license. However, the law says that a license is only required when electricity is supplied to a premises. And if you consider that the definition of premises is land, building or structure, an EV doesn't fall within that definition. So in most cases, selling electricity to the end user of an EV wouldn't be a supply, therefore a license wouldn't be necessary. But in other cases, if the electricity, for instance, is being charged, supplied to a fixed charging infrastructure, that we might see in terms of charging on route, on street charging, then that could be considered supply. And so you'll need to get advice as to whether a license is required from Ofgem. In terms of regulation of hydrogen, which we've talked about a lot, there's currently nothing specific on hydrogen. Hydrogen is a gas, and therefore, as things stand, will be regulated under the Gas Act. Again, you need to consider licensing requirements for gas, because anyone engaging in gas supply or shipping, transportation, etc., will require a license. And as well as that, we'll probably see changes to the gas safety management regulations in terms of use of a different gas, as well as other health and safety issues. So there's a lot of work going on in this area. The Hydrogen Advisory Council is working closely with government and industry to develop hydrogen as a potential source of transport for larger modes of transport, as well as using it for other uses such as heating. In terms of other legal considerations, I'm running short of time, but there's lots to think about. So we talked earlier about reinforcing electricity and gas networks. We need to consider whether any connection agreements are necessary, whether we need to amend any of the industry codes that are associated with that. As with any infrastructure development, we need to consider planning. Planning law issues will arise in terms of the developing the infrastructure, as well as environmental issues with consents. Obviously, all of these things happen on land. So again, consider real estate issues. Do you need to have agreements with freeholders for siting, any charging infrastructure, wayleaves or easements, etc. Health and safety, as I mentioned earlier, general liability issues, as I mentioned with e-scooters. Also consider financing. How are these things going to be financed? Consider different financing structures for building and operating the infrastructure. And then, as Jake mentioned earlier, salary sacrifice schemes, which are popular with employers and very good as a tax efficient scheme, seen as a benefit, but it does require variation of an employee's contract to make that happen, because the employee is actually accepting a lower remuneration in return for the benefit. So again, think about employment contracts. Various commercial agreements, as you can imagine, with all the parties involved, so suppliers, operators, the local authorities that I've mentioned, universities, agreements in relation to the IT infrastructure that will be required, and the various communication systems. And then obviously, the in terms of EVs in particular, we need to consider consumer protection law, because we will be selling electricity to EV users in some cases. And if it isn't covered by that licensing regime that I mentioned, then consumer protection law will apply, as well as data protection in terms of capturing personal data from users of those charging points. And finally, although there probably are lots more legal issues there will be to consider, there will be a lot of regulation around advertising. So already the Advertising Standards Agency governs law around advertising. So need to consider that as well, as and when we start seeing advertisements for this. So I'm a little bit over time. There's a lot to think about, as you've heard from all of us, and we await further detail, but I have had some questions come in, which I can ask.
Apologies, Tracy. I'm gonna have to scoot.
Okay, Phil. Thank you very much.
Yeah, please send them to me, and I'll answer them directly.
Okay, thanks, Phil. We'll follow up on the questions.
Thanks.
Bye-bye. So one of the questions that's come in here is about addressing the issue of end of life battery disposal. Russell, do you have a view on that? How do we dispose of the batteries from these electric vehicles?
It often comes up, what do you do with batteries? You simply just can't throw them out. You do have to seriously think about them. Certainly one area I see as potential use from a grid infrastructure point of view is, so when you see the battery, the fact that they are still usable as batteries, you take those batteries out and you can be able to use them to offer kind of grid services. So imagine taking all these batteries out, and then you can collect these and suddenly make them to like a static battery, and then that potentially offer grid services. This can help balance renewables, and can help manage the frequency on the system to make sure we manage demand and supply on a second by second basis. So there is a lot of options for second life batteries. These are used at the moment as well. Interestingly, this thought has been going back. People have been suggesting this for conventional car batteries as well. What do you do with those? So they are, it's very difficult to get rid of a conventional car battery as well, maybe even work as a lead acid as well. So people have been suggesting just keeping old car batteries as just a continuation of what you can do there. But I am aware, it's slightly out of my area of expertise, I don't know if Jake knows, but there are ways that you can recycle car batteries. This is something that is definitely being thought about there as well. But I can certainly say there's an opportunity for using them as grid balancing services.
I know, yeah, building on what Russell was saying, so there's a company which Engie is investing in, actually, called Connected Energy, which is doing just that. So essentially, yeah, taking second life car batteries, which still have a lot of usable life in them, putting them into big containers and then using that for grid balancing and those services. So it's definitely something which is happening already today.
Thank you. This is more of a comment, I think, than a question per se. One of our participants has said, mass adoption of EB will still result in private property clogging up roads and curbsides, air quality on particles from tyres and brake linings, etc. It's not reality that mass adoption of rail and buses, getting a lot of people to the same place at the same time, is more sensible and responsible. Delivery vehicles have increased during lockdown too. Mining for lithium will result in huge environment degradation. And how can everyone afford much higher electricity bills in years to come? No EV isn't the solution. We need to think less of me.
I think to that point, we've seen car clubs and car share, lift sharing become a lot more popular in the last couple of years, especially because of lockdown, people's finances, they maybe don't want to own a car, which is great. And if someone does have a car down the street, they can have that open for other users when it's not being used. Because a lot of vehicles, just for the majority of the time, just sit there, not being used, which isn't a great asset to have, obviously. And in terms of electricity bills, I think Octopus Energy, I'm sure everyone's seen the success of how Octopus Energy have grown in the last couple of years, specifically around offering fairer pricing on renewable energy, and the fact that we're investing in our own wind farms, in our own solar farms, which enables us to deliver fairer prices, and specific tariffs that we offer to charge cheaper overnight for specific EV drivers, as well as agile tariffs which track the base rate of energy. So over the course of the year, you'll be paying less than if you're on a standard tariff. So we're trying to answer those points that the anonymous attendee was mentioning there.
Just to add on to that slightly, yeah, it's interesting to say lots of street side infrastructure certainly does get mentioned from time to time. So I think that's why you need to make sure that the balance between home, street, destination and kind of rapid charging is right and fits in with the kind of the local environment. What you don't want to do is impede pathways or impede roadways with infrastructure there. You do occasionally see some unfortunate photos of people putting in infrastructure in maybe not the best way, people charging cars in not the best way. So that is something that definitely needs to be considered. And the kind of accessibility, how easy can I charge my vehicle if I have a disability or I would struggle to call normally. So these are things you definitely have to consider that. I think like Jake as well, I'm not sure if I get the energy price point. So bear in mind that you're swapping electricity from fossil fuels and from petrol as well. So we do have to remember, although you will see an increase in electricity demand, you've seen a drastic reduction in energy demand. So the use of oil will drastically decrease as well. And you think of the infrastructure that's required to support that and the investment that goes into that, and where that comes as well. So you do have to look at the whole picture here rather than just focusing on my electricity bill will go up, but think about then what will go down and where, just shifting where that investment will come. So it's really important that we look at the whole picture rather than just focusing on the electricity bill or in any particular area around electric vehicles.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. We are over time. I think it's been a really interesting discussion, and we've heard from great panelists on what's being done. I think it is a watch this space on what comes next in the transport decarbonisation plan. So we'll keep in touch on that. If you've got any questions as participants that you'd like to raise with us, do use the contact details that you've seen on the slides, and we'll follow up with you. And I'd like to thank all the panelists who've joined us today. It's been a really interesting session. So thank you, and I'll leave everyone now to go and have their lunch. Thanks all.
Thanks everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.